sunshine hurts my eye. And something without one love draws heavy on my mind. Oh, then I look at you, and the world is all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gone.
And they say, you are what you are, and that's occasionally and learn from my mistakes. But then the movies tell me I should look like her and laugh like her. If I'm a quiet beauty, all will surely fall in love with me. But the people love me best like the way I laugh, and don't care what I wear. They rather see me loud and proud than stay polite and
Messengers. Hello, everyone. Thank you so much. Good morning. Hello. How are you? How are you at home? Welcome, welcome, welcome. I want to start off by letting you all know that those of us who are not wearing a mask up here on the platform, we tested negative this morning. We do this just to, oh my goodness, take care of each other in the best way we possibly can. So I want to make sure you all know that, and those of you at home know also that we are on the ancestral land of the Kalapuya people, and we affirm indigenous history, experiences, and sovereignty. Now, if you are new or newish to our community, we're good. If you are new or newish to our community, please know that we are an inclusive, progressive, and compassionate community that is dedicated to spirit-led social action in the world. We do our own work, and we take that out into the world to make it a better place for all people. And just know that here at the New Thought Center for Spiritual Living, all people, all faith paths are welcome. And not only are you welcome here, but we have mindfully and we have thoughtfully created a place just for you, exactly as you are this day, right now, this moment. Goodness, goodness, you are welcome here in this safe sanctuary, this safe place. If you would like more information about what we are up to here, and we are up to a lot, I invite you to go to our website, newthoughtcsl.org, or if for those of you who are here locally, on your way out, you can grab all kinds of info that is on our tables upstairs and down. All of you in the room, I invite you to turn around and just wave to the folks that are at home so that we feel the sense of connection, knowing there is truly no separation. We are all here as one. So with that, I invite us all to take a deep breath in as I invite Reverend Masando up for our opening blessing.
So I invite us, as we have taken that deep breath, to simply settle into this very place where we find ourselves. Right here where we sit, right here where we stand. We just come into the awareness of this presence of something deeper within us that is always guiding us, always cheering us on, always protecting us. This still small voice that has been with us from the very beginning, we come to know this as the very presence of the divine within, this intuition, this sense of knowing, this deep trust that allows us to meet every single step of our life and to do so with great faith, with incredible trust, and with abundant joy, knowing that each and every moment of our lives is already blessed by this same living spirit of the divine within. And so we just say thank you. We say yes. And we recognize our entire life, every moment, every breath, as the very breath of the divine itself, that we are living and moving within and as and with this living spirit within. And so how good it is. How good it is to feel this deep connection with that voice within, with that presence within, and to know that, that same voice, that same presence is connected to everyone and everything. And so we feel that connection to the entire planet and each other as well. And so we just rest into this. We allow it to be the truest truth of who we are. And we let it be so. And so it is. Now I'm going to ask Brian to lead us in our spiritual practice today.
Thank you, Reverend Masando. Now is the time for our spiritual practice. We're going to do this through song. I invite you to stand as you're able. This is the time to just be present with the spirit, to engage with the music however you feel moved. You can sing along. You can dance. You can just be still and let it wash over you.
We let
let the joy.
We let the joy wash over us. We let it be. We let the joy wash over us.
Good morning. My name is Diane Van Dyke, and this is an excerpt from Fragrance After Rain by J.A. Jung. You are qualified to bloom. Blooming is not only for flowers or springtime. You are qualified. Heal. To thrive. You don't just live, you feel alive. You don't have to wait on more education, the right job, a good hair day, better seasoning in your food, being in better shape, more money, less stress, new shoes. Easier opportunities, rainbows, full moons, friendship, a stronger back, weaker resistance, someone's permission, or anyone to understand you. Bloom now. Bloom now. Bloom now, you miraculous, somewhat unbelievably unlimited alphabet of glory and mystery. Bloom now. Introduce us to the language of petals. You are qualified to bloom in every way. Give yourself permission. Release your lifetime of doubt and fear and insecurities. How about with a daily song? I am qualified. I am worthy. I belong. I am a blossoming thing. I dance in the sunlight. I arch my wings. And I am kin to beautiful, beautiful things. It's never too late. It's never too soon. And now, I believe. Blessed be. Thank you.
Thank you, Diane. Please welcome Darcy Bradley.
Darcy Bradley and the New Thought Messengers. Oh, that's such a fun song to dance to. Bow, 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 bow. But I'm going to get to that in a minute. Thank you, Susie. Yes, dancing is my jam. So, I want to talk this morning I want to start by reminding everyone here, all of our beloveds online, that joy is your birthright. Joy, right now, July 2022, in the United States of America, and wherever it is that you are watching us from, joy is your birthright. There is a story that I love, and it's a Buddhist story. It's about a person who was traveling, a sojourner, if you will. This person was traveling and came to the edge of a river and realized that they couldn't cross the river. It was too deep for them. And so this person was just flummoxed. They didn't know what to do. They didn't know how to cross the river. So they went to the Buddha and they asked the Buddha, how am I supposed to cross this river? The Buddha smiled and the Buddha said, make a raft. Right. So this person, spirituality is often really simple. Let's just be clear. Okay, not complicated, truly. So this person went, oh, well, yes, of course, duh. And this person made the raft, and it was a big, beautiful raft that got this person safely across the river to the other side. And this person was so grateful that this raft helped them get to the other side of their journey that they continued along their journey carrying this very big raft. Even though there were no rivers in sight, this person just kept carrying the raft just in case. So after a very, 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 very long journey of carrying this big, rather cumbersome raft, this traveler came to the edge of a forest. And this forest beckoned to this traveler. This forest had tall, lush, beautiful trees. It was a beautiful place. And this person stood at the edge of this forest and thought, okay, this is the next step of my journey. And this person picked up their big, cumbersome raft. And they started moving through the trees. But what was happening is the raft kept bumping into the trees. The raft that they'd been carrying was getting in the way of them taking their next steps. And so this person had to stop and was faced with a decision. Either they could stop their journey and just continue holding their raft, or they could put the raft down. They could lay the raft down, trusting that they would be able to make their way safely through the forest to the other side of their journey. Now, this begs the question for all of us. Is there a raft that you have been carrying around that has helped you in the past, but that is no longer serving you? In fact, could this raft actually be hindering your progress forward? And what is that raft for you? And are you willing to lay it down so that you can move forward? That raft could be an old idea about something or old patterns. It could be old behaviors or relationships that served you at one time but that are now getting in the way of your soul growth. What is that raft for you? Note to self, we all have one. We all have one. And it may be very true that that raft served or supported you for a time in your life, for a season in your life. Not all, but some do. Some actually had great value for you. Some rafts might have even been lifesavers for you. And so it behooves us then, there is great value then, to bless that raft with gratitude as you lay it down. No need for drama with this. And I mean that. You know, that is a choice, of course. Sometimes folks unconsciously create drama thinking that it will make putting the raft down easier. Do you know what I'm talking about? Anybody? Right? The spiritual truth, the fact of the matter is, it doesn't. Creating drama in order to lay that raft down, let that thing go, does not serve. It does not help. You have an opportunity to be spiritually mature here and to recognize the value that it gave you, maybe even the huge importance that it was in your life for a season. But taking the next step often requires that we lay down what we no longer need to carry. Because if we don't lay it down, we can end up abandoning ourselves. The great news, though, is that with each step we take, after we lay that thing down, with each step we take moving forward, we are never alone. I love the line from the Hebrew scripture in Genesis. It's so beautiful. It says, "I am with you and will keep you wherever you go." I am with you and will keep you wherever you go. We are never alone as we make our journey forward, as we take each step in our life. Today I'm talking about moving forward in your life, growing and expanding. Taking the next step is my talk title today. However big or small that step may be, so that ultimately you can experience more joy in your life. That's the reason for these steps, you see? That's the reason for spiritual growth, so that you can experience more joy, more harmony, more peace, and then be a beacon for that out into the world. And in my experience, along our path, us humans vacillate between three categories. Are you ready? All right. Here's the deal. Most of us regularly cross-pollinate between these three categories depending on our personality, current life journey, our mood, and what is impacting our current state of mind. Now, ideally, we don't stay in one of these three categories. This said, I do believe, in my experience, is that all three of these categories are part of our shared human experience. So the first category that can impede us taking steps forward in our life, the first category is when we're just not sure what step to take. We've all been there, right? I know I have. And this can end up causing a feeling of inertia, of frustration or stuckness, of overwhelm. When we experience this, we just can't get in touch with what our soul is calling us towards. This is when we have that feeling of stuckness. And as a result, we can either stay in the energy of frustration. Sometimes we go into denial or addiction or just a kind of numbed out neutrality. My friends, we are not here to be numbed out or neutral. Know that. But it's very easy to sort of slip into this feeling of stuckness. Many of us experienced this in 2020. Are you with me? Lockdown, right? What an opportunity to get to have that experience and move through it. Wayne Dyer, bless him, Wayne Dyer wrote, "Taking action is how we increase our connectedness to spirit." Taking action is how we increase our connectedness to spirit. So let me connect some dots here for you. If you are in that sort of meh feeling, or that kind of I have no clue, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. Space, I get it. I've been there. Here is the deal. God, love, source is not stagnant. There's nothing meh about God. Right? And so when we are meh, often what is happening is we have forgotten our spiritual truth. Spirit, the divine, is active. And we are always being called into this flow of divine activity. Look at creation. It doesn't ever stop creating. Creation is constantly creating, all we need to do is look outside. It's always, even in the depths of winter, there is so much activity happening under the cold earth. Now, just because spirit is active, that does not mean that we are supposed to be busy. Far from it. It's quite different energetically. The thing is spirit is what animates us. And we are called to meet this flow, to go with the flow, not to remain stuck or stagnant. A spiritual tool that we don't talk a lot about, that I want to start really bringing into this community on a regular basis, is the spiritual practice of moving your body. Moving your body in whatever way and whatever level feels good for you. It doesn't matter if you are sitting in a chair and just gently swaying to music. Music that you love, or swimming, or walking, or gardening, or starting a yoga practice, or weightlifting, or standing here in church and maybe moving your body in the safety of this space during that beautiful opening spiritual practice. And what I'm talking about here has nothing to do with fitness. It is about connecting with the flow and the movement of the divine within you and all around you. We start our services on Sunday morning mindfully with the spiritual practice. We ask you to stand, and I hope those of you at home that you stand with us if you're watching the whole service. It's an opportunity to connect and to feel the flow of spirit through your body. All the great faith traditions and cultures for millennia have used movement as a way to connect with the divine in their body. And if you can make the decision to consciously move your body, even in the smallest way that feels right, with intention, the intention to feel spirit within you and all around you, you will connect with the indwelling spiritual energy that is activating your life. You know, the couch potato thing keeps us at a distance from remembering the activity of spirit within our lives. When we zone out, that is not doing anything for our connection to God. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay. And so consciously doing this, moving your body temple, this is a form of spiritual practice, especially when you are feeling stuck or frustrated or numb in any way. It can really help to dislodge stagnation and support your natural flow. And I understand when you are feeling that way, often moving is the very last thing you want to do on planet Earth, right? So if you are feeling stuck right now, or if you at some point down the line find yourself in that place, I want you to anchor yourself to this moment and allow the energy of this room to remind you, these beloveds here and this spiritual practice that we're talking about, to just turn the music on and just even start swaying. Just that. Are you willing? That will head it off at a pass faster than anything I know. So with that, I invite you to take a deep breath. And now, keeping this in mind, gently and compassionately and silently ask yourself, what is something that I can do in my life that would ultimately bring me more joy? What is something that I can do in my life that will ultimately bring me more joy? And what raft do I need to lay down to make that happen? Being so gentle, so compassionate with yourself. I invite you to take another deep breath in and return to me in this moment. Now, the next category, the second category that can hinder us when we are trying to take the next step in our life is dun-dun-dun-dun, perfectionism, fear of failure. Nobody here said no one ever. We have all either swam in the deep end of perfectionism or certainly at least dipped our toe in it from time to time in our lives. Yes? Okay. So this universal shared human experience is both so very common and so very sad. The unconscious and often ingrained until it is healed protective mechanism of perfectionism is a tape that is often playing out from early childhood or adolescence or early adulthood. And all perfectionism does is keep us small and isolated. That is it. That's it. Perfectionism and fear of failure are our ego's most prized possessions. Most prized possessions. Our ego thinks that it's keeping us safe. But the saddest thing is that when we stay imprisoned in that form of dysfunction, it prevents us from taking our next right steps forward. My friends, the perfectionist would still be back at the edge of the river trying to figure out the best design for the raft, making many blueprints, but not yet quite lifting a finger, or maybe creating the raft and then dismantling the raft and doing it again because it needed to be just right. Anybody? Okay. We humans are so funny, aren't we? We do that all the time. We do that all the time, and all it does is rob us of our joy. It robs us of the ability to move forward. If you struggle with perfectionist tendencies in any way, I highly recommend Brené Brown's book, The Gifts of Imperfection. And if you've read it, I invite you to reread it. In it, she writes, perfectionism is not the same thing as striving to be your best. It's a shield. It's a 20-ton shield that we lug around, thinking it will protect us, when in fact, it's the thing that's really preventing us from flight. So again, I invite you to take a deep breath in. And keeping this in mind, bless you. Gently, compassionately, and silently ask yourself, what is something that I can do in my life that will ultimately bring me more joy? And what raft do I need to lay down to make that happen? Maybe you've added to your list, or maybe it's the same thing. Today is about getting clarity. What is something that I can do in my life that would ultimately bring me more joy, and what raft do I need to lay down to make that happen? I now invite you to take another deep breath in and return to me as I move into the third and final characteristic of us humans when it comes to taking next steps. Some of us can get, shall we say, distracted. There's a very old, old, old Russian proverb that says, if you chase two rabbits, you will not catch either one. Nope. In our current world, focusing on one thing is not easy. There are so many distractions all the time. So many second rabbits or shiny squirrels, as some people call them. You know? And to top that off, some of us may have so many ideas that are really shiny and wonderful that we are unable to complete our next step because we keep getting distracted by those shiny objects, by Netflix or Instagram or cleaning out the closet or doing the thing that I was doing a minute ago, but I can't remember what I was doing because I went into the other room to do that other thing, and then I checked my phone, and then my brother called, and oh my gosh, he's got a new little baby boy, and isn't that great? And what was I doing again in that other room? Oh yeah, my closet. Oh no, wait. I know, I've got to get that thing for the thing and go there and do what again? Anybody? We can all feel like we have multiple plates in the air. And I am certainly from the era of this idea that multitasking was a good thing. Remember when that was like cool? When the ability to multitask was somehow a badge of honor, which we now know is completely incorrect. In fact, there is a study called Multi-Costs of Multitasking by Kevin Madori and Anthony Wagner. And they explain, the scientific study of multitasking over the past few decades has revealed that, in fact, we inflate our perceived ability to multitask. There is little correlation with our actual ability in this. In fact, they say, multitasking is almost always a misnomer, as the human mind and brain lack the architecture to perform two or more tasks simultaneously. Oh, okay. I had to stop for a second, you know? It's like, gosh. They go on, when it comes to brain functioning, it's more accurate to use the term switch tasking instead of multitasking, because that is what the human brain does. It switches tasks. It does not multitask. And so then I started thinking about this because, you know, here in New Thought, in our metaphysical teaching, we understand that what we focus on increases. Where we put our attention, whatever we place our attention on, it grows that. Good or not so good. So we always want to be mindful about what it is that we are placing our attention on repetitively. Because when we are consistent in our focus on whatever that thing is, and we hone in on it, it will grow. Always, always, always. This is ancient wisdom. This is also modern science. Now, if you find yourself in this category, maybe a lot or you dip into it, fear not, there is a spiritual solution, I promise. It is one of the greatest gifts that you can give yourself. We teach it here. We talk about it all the time. And it is the gift of a regular meditation practice. Can you all take a deep breath and just, how good that is, this idea of a regular meditation practice. Even just the breath slowed everything down, didn't it? Didn't it? And when I say a meditation practice, I know that there are many sweet squirrels out here who are saying, no meditation for me. I get it. I was one of them for a very long time. When I was taking my prerequisites, my certified classes to become a practitioner, I had to take treatment of meditation twice. I had to take meditation twice because it was just hard. It was hard for me. It took me a long time, and now I cannot live without it. Are you kidding me? Even just a breath. Even if you start with 5 or 10 minutes of guided meditation is best if you identify as a squirrel or if you chase rabbits, guided meditation. You can get an app for your phone. You can listen to them. And over time, it will help you immensely. For those of you who already meditate and you navigate the rabbits in your life, I invite you to increase your time in meditation, even by a little, or consider doing it twice a day, breaking it up and doing it twice a day. And over time, which is key, it takes time, but over time, it is a magic elixir. Getting quiet helps us to hear our inner nudges and focus directed energy. So once more, I invite you to take a deep breath in, keeping this in mind. Gently and compassionately and silently ask yourself again, what is something that I can do in my life that would ultimately bring me more joy? And what raft do I need to lay down to make this happen? Take in a deep breath, and please come back. My intention for you today is that you leave here, or you complete watching this or listening to this, with at least one thing, if not three or more, at least one thing that you have identified that you can do in order to bring more joy into your life, a step that you can take, and what is directly connected to that is the raft that you will let go in order to do that. You can't have one without the other. Releasing the old to step into the new. That is how it works. It's how it's worked for thousands of years. It's what metaphysics teaches us. And every step you take from this place of consciousness, of being fully awake, as the Buddha said, will bring you joy. I've been reading Jaya John's book, Fragrance After Rain. It is bringing me joy. That was the excerpt of the reading that we had earlier from Diane. Thank you again, Diane. Was from his book. And in it, Dr. Jaya writes, have you worked out your joy today? Make sure you get your reps in. In a depressed, anxious world, you can train your brain for joy. Your brain is imminently teachable, a faithful student. It develops an appetite for the thoughts you feed it. Live each moment from the pain to the passion as though it is a miracle. Allow tears of art to soften your soul. This is how you flood your brain with wonder and all the wonder chemicals that heal you. As your brain becomes wonderful, joy moves in, takes up residence. Then joy takes over your brain. Joy is a gifted interior decorator. And you're gonna love the place. Yes. Yes. Joy is your birthright. And I invite you to take the next step towards that. As you go into your week and begin to really lean into what it is that you can do in your life to bring you joy, if you begin to feel sluggishness or inertia or uncertainty, move your body in whatever way you can. Remember, spirit is in motion. If you are being hard on yourself, read, reread, or listen to Brené Brown's The Gifts of Imperfection, or engage in any kind of spiritual study that reinforces your self-worth. Reverend Masando and I talk about self-worth every week, just about, don't we? We add it in there, salt and pepper. You can listen to any one of our talks, and it will reinforce that for you, if that helps. If you're trying to take a step in a particular direction and you're being pulled between distracting rabbits or squirrels, meditate. Just get quiet. Even if you put your hand on your heart and you take a breath. This will support you. I speak from experience. And finally, my friends, whatever raft you are still lugging around, lay it down. It's time. Your joy awaits. Let's pray. I invite the practitioners forward. And as they're making their way forward, let's all take a deep, deep breath and return again to that interior wisdom of the indwelling spirit, that place within each one of us that is the place where love lives, the place where spirit exists, the place where God is in the most gentle, magnificent, and glorious way. I am so grateful for this love. I'm so grateful for this life that is always propelling us forward in whatever way, in the smallest ways and in the largest ways, whatever it may be, whether it is a new job or a new place or a new state of being. This next step is an opportunity for greater joy, for greater order, for a greater experience of light on this planet. In this moment, I bless, on behalf of all of us, our friends and family, surrounding them with this same light. I bless our beloved Reverend Masando and Rebecca and the wee baby in her belly as they take their next step to Colorado, to raise their wee one. What a blessing. I celebrate this clarity for them. I celebrate their next glorious steps. And I celebrate, on behalf of each one of us, the step that we take this day, the decision, the conscious decision that we make to move our body, to feel spirit in motion, to meditate or to get clarity, to read, to study, to learn, to grow, to expand, to be in community together. What a blessing to be in this life, to take these next steps individually on behalf of the whole, recognizing that we are one human family, and every step we take in aligned consciousness benefits every being on the seen and unseen sides of life. The ripple effect is that magnificent. And so in this moment, I bless all people everywhere, people who gather in churches and mosques and synagogues and temples and ashrams and yoga mats and living rooms and picket lines and vigils and marches and community organizing meetings. I bless all people who gather together, recognizing the one love at the center of each of us, that we are taking steps forward, affirming, knowing, and being. And so from this place of grace, I give so much gratitude for the next step I take and the next step each one of us takes. I am so grateful for this and for so much more. I allow it all to be and to be manifest. And so it is. Blessed be. And so it is. Let's take a deep breath. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So this is our time of conscious giving. This is the time where we have an opportunity to pay it forward. I want to say thank you in advance. All of your gifts contribute to everything we're doing here and the ways that we live our values out into the world. You can text to give, you can mail in a check, you can become a pledger, which is marvelous. Whatever works for you, I want to say thank you. With that, let us together say our blessing. From the love of pure spirit within me, I bless this gift. I send it forth to heal and bless and prosper. It does good work in the world and returns to me multiplied abundantly. And so it is. Thank you. And now I want to acknowledge once again Darcy Bradley. Hello.
Thank you so much, Darcy. And as I mentioned in the prayer, our beloved Reverend Masando and Rebecca are heading to Colorado next week. And my goodness, we are so grateful for the lifelong friendship. I will carry you in my heart always. Always. We're going to be gathering on the patio. I'll tell you more about that afterwards to give them a community blessing. But we've chosen a very special song in honor of the Hiraokas. Take it away.
Thank you for being a friend. Travel down the road and back again. Your heart is true. You're a pal and a confidant. I'm not ashamed to say I hope it always will stay this way. My hat is off. Won't you stand up and take a bow?
Here with you.
Woo. Ah, that was so special. Thank you all.
You are so welcome.
Y'all can be my golden girls forever.
Why not?
I got some announcements real quick before we go. We had some great signups last week already for our community-wide retreat, which is called Stepping into the Sacred, a time for spiritual practices, connection, and joy. So Rev S has created this retreat for all of us, for you, and she will guide you in new and deep spiritual practices designed to support and to nurture you at that deep soul level. So just come celebrate your divinity, deepen your relationship with Spirit and, of course, with each other. And this all-inclusive retreat will be held at the amazing Canby Retreat Center in Canby, Oregon, right on the Malala River. It is gorge.
So gorgeous.
It has limited space availability. It will sell out fast. So $75 will hold your spot. You can sign up right outside. Or if you're tuning in online and you want to come in town for this retreat, it's a great way to connect with folks. You can do so at newthoughtcsl.org. Everyone will be testing the morning of the retreat, so Everyone can just be together, mask-free, and in that space. That sounds amazing. Next, we also have another class coming up. Shelley Walker is going to be doing our spiritual economics class. Well, she'll explore metaphysical principles which govern our financial wellness. So whether you're wanting to heal your own relationship with money, I know we all got stuff with money, or create a healthy financial life for yourself, or just build on the prosperity that you have, you can come into this class, connect with each other, and with these principles to apply them to your life. So just be 6 Monday nights beginning August 1st through September 5th from 6:30 to 8:30. And with this class, we're offering a special summer discount savings of $70 off the normal tuition. So if you want to sign up, again, you can just go outside and sign up. Or if you're tuning in online, go to newthoughtcsl.org. And lastly, you know, as a nonprofit, we're a nonprofit organization. We're always looking for innovative ways to fundraise, and our stewardship team has been putting together some creative ideas to do this. So next Sunday, July 31st, we'll have our very first fifth Sunday match fundraiser. And so every fifth Sunday, 100% of the collection that happens on the Sunday will go to support the programming that we create for you here at the center and maximize the collection we receive. So our core contributors will be matching whatever collection we take on that Sunday, so your dollars will go twice the amount that they normally do. So thank you to our core contributors. Next Sunday will be a really great Sunday to donate a little bit more, knowing that's like a one-up, a multiplier on what you can give. So thank you so much for participating in that. And Rev S has our last announcement for the day.
Yes, and so a reminder again to all of you who are here, we are celebrating Rev Masando and Rebecca's next adventure as they travel back to Colorado in preparation to raise their baby there with family. And we will be gathering actually upstairs today out in the courtyard to give them a community blessing and be able to share some gratitudes. And just a note, because Rebecca is pregnant, we're requesting no hugs and actually to keep your masks on, if you would, for that portion of it. We will also outside have a very special cake made by our pastry chef, Merritt, who is a congregant here. He made it for the occasion. Merritt, thank you, dear one. It's a carrot cake, right? We'll also have fruit for those of you who are sugar-free, everything. The point is to be together and to celebrate this glorious human. We'll have a little bit of music out there and a lot of love. So I would like to invite the practitioners back down forward. And as they are making their way, for those of you online, since you are not going to be here in person, I'm going to invite you to do what our daughters did back when they were very little and send Reverend Masando, Rebecca, and their baby a rainbow of love from wherever you are in the country and in the world. So just know that prayer support will be here and available for you directly following this service. So you, even though we're having that outside, if you need prayer, stay. These practitioners are here to serve and uplift you. Those of you online, please go to the bottom of our homepage, and you can look for after-service online prayer support if you would like prayer support today. I want to honor all the people watching us online from all over the place, California, Colorado, Florida, Iowa, and all over Oregon. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for all of you who have chosen to be here in person. What a blessing it is to get to share this energy together. So with that, let us stand for our final blessing as you are able. May you go in the light, as the light, and with the light until we meet again. May the longtime sun shine upon you, all love surround you, and the pure light within you guide you on your way. You are loved.
I really